why your hypothesis isn't right or wrong. An important part of scientific method involves coming up with and testing a hypothesis, which is a prediction of what we think we will observe based on what we already know. Say your science teacher asks you to come up with your own experiment about something you want to investigate, which is perfect timing because your lab partner has taken up the new hobby of racing snails and wants to find a way to make them go faster. Hey, it could catch on. Anyway, you both think that you could motivate the snails to race their fastest using the power of music, and it doesn't get much more motivational than the song Eye of the Tiger. Trust me, you'll know it when you hear it. The hypothesis you come up with together is that if snails are played the song Eye of the Tiger, then they'll complete their race faster, or in other words, their race time will be reduced, with the independent variable being whether or not they played the song, and the dependent variable being their race time. You agree that the materials that you need are a measured out snail racetrack, a copy of the song and something to play it on, and some kind of stopwatch or timer to time the snail's race times. And the snails, of course. You get to conduct your experiment, remember that snails are slow, and possibly regret some of your life decisions. On with the results section. We're going to put them in a table, remembering, of course, to give our table a title that is descriptive enough that if someone saw your table without the rest of the report, they would still have an idea of what you did in your experiment. In terms of setting up our table, we of course want to include our racing snails and their race times, remembering to include units, which we did in minutes. We want to include our control condition, so their race times when the song wasn't played, and of course the results for our test condition, when the song was played. Let's just say the first snail completed the racetrack in 45 minutes when the song wasn't played, and then 47 minutes when the song was played. The second snail took 54 minutes without the song, and 51 minutes when the song was played. And our third snail took 49 minutes both times. So what's the dealio? Well, from my experience, this is where students go on in their discussion section and analyze each snail's individual results. Saying things like, maybe snail 1 took longer to complete their race with the song playing because they don't really like music. And then, because it kind of supports the hypothesis, they'll go on for ages about how snail 2 was inspired by the music and improved their race time by 3 minutes. Keeping in mind too that we weren't measuring whether or not snails like music or their levels of inspiration. Then these students usually conclude that their hypothesis was correct. Usually, when you talk to these students and ask them how they concluded that, they admit that they're afraid they're going to lose marks because their hypothesis was wrong. In fact, if there's anything I want you to take away from this video, is that hypotheses aren't necessarily right or wrong, or correct or incorrect. Your hypothesis is either supported by your data, or just not. A good word to use when it's not supported is refuted, or you could just say not supported. So going back to our snails, I've put our data into a graph so we can visualize it a bit better, which yes, would have a title, but it wouldn't fit on the screen. One thing that we're not going to do is pick and choose parts of the data to focus on and parts to ignore. Rather, we're going to look at our data overall. If we look at the amount of time it took each snail to finish the racetrack when the song was being played, in comparison to when the song wasn't played, overall we can see that one took 2 minutes slower, one was 3 minutes faster, and another one it seemed to have no effect. And if we step back and look at the broader picture, we can see that each snail took a really long time to complete the racetrack, almost an hour each time. Is a difference of 2 or 3 minutes really that significant then? Probably not. Would we conclude then that our hypothesis wasn't supported? Yeah, and there's nothing wrong with that. Spoiler alert, snails don't actually have ears, so they can't hear. But they can feel vibrations, which might be a good starting place to redesign our experiment. If your data refutes your hypothesis, it doesn't mean that you're wrong or you've failed in any way. You just didn't observe what you predicted. When we study science in schools, we have to get through heaps of topics really quickly, so it's very rare we get to repeat experiments. But when you conduct experiments as part of a science career, it's more of an ongoing process. And while you may have hypotheses, you genuinely don't know how things are going to turn out. So your results and whether or not they support your hypothesis inform the next lot of experiments. When things don't go as they're predicted, they can actually lead to really cool discoveries. And if you're still worried about losing marks, just talk to your teacher. Please remember to support this channel by subscribing, and leave this video a like if you liked it. Please comment below if this video was helpful for you, any constructive criticism, ideas or requests for future videos, and share any awesome lesson ideas with our fellow edumacators.